Welcome all of you to today's lecture of air conditioning. Today we will study about a very interesting topic, that how room air conditioners work, and I will explain you the working principle with the help of taking an example of a window air conditioner. Basically, window air conditioner and split air conditioners working principle is same, only their difference is in the arrangement. And I will tell you about that, okay? And in the course of today's lecture, we will also study about these very important topics, that how evaporator coils work, their working principle, condenser coils working principle, and why we use compressor. What is the need of compressor? Very important question. And finally, the movement of air. That means the direction of the flow of air inside the air conditioner. Okay, now we will start. This image is the interior of the window air conditioner, and this is the outer image of window air conditioner. Both these images are very important to explain the working principle. Okay, we will start with this. See, when you switch on the air conditioner, what happens is that there is a blower inside this air conditioner. Suppose I assume that the blower starts rotating in clockwise direction. Then what will happen? The room air, which is warmer, it will move into the air conditioner because of the suction process. And this room air moves into the air conditioner through this passage. Okay, you can see. Now, when it enters into the air conditioner, cooling operation takes place, and the colder air comes back into the room through these flaps. Okay, through this passage. Okay, so this passage is for the entry of the warm air, and this passage is the exit of the cool air from the air conditioner. Okay, so the cool air is also coming back into the room, and this cool air will again enter into the air conditioner, and more cooling will take place. Okay, and again the even colder air will come back into the room. Okay, so there is a recirculation process. Okay, now what is happening inside the air conditioner is very important. The how the cooling operation is taking place is very important, and we will study about that here. See, when you switch on the AC, the first things that happens is the thermostat is set on. What is thermostat? See, I am writing here. The first thing that happens is that thermostat is set on. Inside a thermostat, there is a sensor. Okay? Suppose your room air, it is in temperature, suppose 30 degrees Celsius. And the temperature you have set in the air conditioner, which you want to achieve in your room, is 22 degrees Celsius, suppose. I hope that you are understanding what I am trying to say. This is the temperature you have set in the air conditioning, in the air conditioner. Now, the thermostat sensor senses that there is some difference in this temperature. Okay? And to achieve this 22 degrees Celsius from 30 degrees Celsius, cooling operation needs to occur. Who is sensing this operation? Thermostat. Thermostat is sensing that to achieve this temperature, cooling operation must take place. And thus your air conditioner starts working at that time. Okay. Now we will move into the working principle of air conditioner. Now, the cooling operation begins with the start of this blower. Blower is a type of fan. Okay, how it functions, I'm showing you here. When blower starts to rotate, suppose I assume that this blower is starting to rotate in clockwise direction. This is the motor. This is the motor of the blower, and this is the structure of the blower. Okay, now when this blower is starting to rotate in clockwise direction, then the warm air from the room is sucked into the air conditioner. Is it clear or not? The warm air that is present inside the room, it is sucked into the air conditioner. Okay, now this warm air passes through the evaporator coils. Cooling operation takes place. This warm air passes through the evaporator coils. These coils you can see here are nothing but evaporator coils. Now cooling takes place. Now what happens is that due to the rotation of the blower, the air after being cooled, it flows like this. Okay, and it comes back into the room as cold air. I'm repeating once more, the warm air, it is passing through the evaporator coils, it is cooling down, and due to the action of the blower, it is, since the blower is rotating in this direction, the air is flowing like this and it is coming back into the room. When the air is coming back into the room, it is of course much colder. It is of course much colder. But one thing that is very important, that is the warm air that is entering into the air conditioner does not directly meets the evaporator coils. Does not directly passes into the evaporator coils. Okay, I'm telling you. What I mean to say is that the room air, it is warm or cold, it is warm. Before it is meeting the evaporator coil, you can see here, this is before meeting the evaporator coil, it needs to pass through series of filters. There are two types of filters. First comes primary filter, then secondary filter. Okay. Now, due to the action of blower, the room air is sucked into the air conditioner. And before moving into the evaporator coil, if I assume that these are your evaporator coils, before moving into the evaporator coils, it needs to pass through a series of filters. Okay, why these filters are necessary, I am explaining you. So the room air is passing to filters. Now the filters are necessary to trap the dust particles. We know that this room air contains lots of dust particles. Okay, now if I allow these dust particles to move into the air conditioner, then what effect will it have? See, there are coils, evaporator coils. These dust particles will get trapped on the surface of the evaporator coils. Also, it will trap on the surface of the blower. Okay, if the dust particles trap on the surface of the evaporator coils, what will happen? Heat transfer will decrease. And the entire air conditioning thing is nothing but playing with heat transfer. More you can do heat transfer, more is the efficiency of the air conditioner. So we need to remove dust particles first. So before this warm air from the room is entering into the evaporator coils, there must be some filters. Filters I have not shown in this diagram. There must be some filters. Okay. So what I told you is that First comes primary filters. In primary filters, coarse particles, coarse dust particles are trapped. Coarse means bigger size. And in secondary filter, smaller size dust particles are trapped. That means fine dust particles are trapped. After passing through this, after the warm air when passes through this filter, it is allowed to move into the evaporator coils for cooling purpose. Is it clear or not? See, it is allowed to move into the evaporator coil for cooling purpose. Now what we have to understand is that how evaporator coils work. It is very simple. You just follow my lecture, you will understand. Now suppose that this is my evaporator coils. Okay. When warm air from the room is passing through this evaporator coil, it is coming out as colder air. Its temperature is decreasing. Okay. Wait. Now you can see the full image. So its temperature is dropping down. But the question that comes to our mind immediately is that how this cooling is taking place? See, there is a refrigerant that is passing through this evaporator coils. Okay. This refrigerant is coming from condenser. After passing through the evaporator coils, it is moving to compressor. See, when I will explain to you, you will find that it is very interesting and also very simple. Now see, the refrigerant is flowing through this evaporator coils. Now, when it is entering from the condenser, the temperature of the refrigerant is suppose 0 to 5 degrees Celsius and it is in liquid state. It is in liquid state. Okay. That's why you can imagine that 0 to 5 degrees Celsius means very cold. Sometimes it is also minus 10 degrees Celsius, the temperature. That means it is very cold. If you touch the evaporator coil, you will feel the chill. Okay. Now, what is the temperature of the warm air that is entering into the evaporator coils? It is same as the room temperature. Suppose I assume it 30 degrees Celsius. Okay. Now, when it passes through this coil, which is almost at, if I assume 2 degrees Celsius or something 3 degrees Celsius or even minus 10, minus 5 degrees Celsius, whatever. Okay. This coil is at a much lesser temperature compared to this 30 degrees Celsius. So, when warm air will pass through this evaporator coil, it will lose its heat to the refrigerant that is flowing through this coil. Okay, it will lose its heat. Okay. And thereby, the air that will flow, that is coming out of the evaporator coil, it is much colder. It is much colder because it has lost some heat to the refrigerant. And the liquid refrigerant takes up the heat and its temperature increases. And its temperature increases to its boiling point. Because we know that the refrigerant that we use in these coils have very, very less boiling point. Its boiling point is very less. Suppose 10 degrees Celsius is its boiling point. So, by taking the heat, it will reach to 10 or 15 degrees Celsius and it will become vaporized. And that it will pass to compressor. That I will explain you later on. But We have understood that how the air, roof, warm air from the room, it is entering into the evaporator coils and it is becoming colder air. But one question I want to ask you here is that only cooling action is taking place in this evaporator coils? Only cooling, no other process? Tell me. My dear friend, another process is taking place. That is called dehumidification. That is called dehumidification. Okay. That is a very simple process. How it is taking place, I am explaining to you. Some people tell me that, sir, your lectures are very long, but I cannot help you regarding this matter. If you need to understand in depth, you have to invest some time. So come back to our topic. What I'm going to explain you now is dehumidification. How the dehumidification is taking place and why we require this process. Both the things I'm going to explain to you. Okay. See, when the warm air from the room, it is entering, what is its temperature, approximate temperature? Suppose 30 degrees Celsius. And what is its relative humidity? The relative humidity in summer days, it is suppose 90%. It is an extremely uncomfortable condition. Temperature 30, 35, 40 sometimes, and also relative humidity 90%, very uncomfortable situation. Now suppose if I pass this warm air through the evaporator coils and only I decrease its temperature, suppose I have decreased its temperature to 25 degrees Celsius, you will feel there is some cooling effect. Suppose this air is passing to your room, okay. This colder air of 25 degrees Celsius is passing to your room. You will feel that there is some cooling effect, but you will not feel much comfortable. Okay. Why you will not feel much comfortable? You will not feel the relaxation you want or comfort you want, because humidity is still 93% or 90%, whatever. Here humidity is same. So we need to decrease the humidity also. To get the real comfort, we also need to decrease the humidity to somewhat 63% or 64%. Okay. So in this evaporator, cooling and dehumidification, both the process takes place. Okay. Cooling and dehumidification. How this dehumidification takes place? See, very simple. The air that is entering in the evaporator coil, its temperature is what? 30 degrees Celsius. But when it is leaving the evaporator coil, its temperature is 25 degrees Celsius. Or you can assume it is 20 degrees Celsius, whatever. So temperature is much less. Okay, there is difference in temperature. Now, my dear friend, I have one question. If pressure is same, but I decrease the temperature, will the air be able to hold the same amount of moisture it was initially having? At 30 degrees Celsius, my air was having some amount of moisture. Okay. Now, I am decreasing the temperature by cooling operation to 20 degrees Celsius. Okay. Now, will it be able to hold the same amount of moisture? No, because in all of my psychrometric videos, I've told you this repeatedly, that if temperature decreases, then moisture content of the air also decreases. Okay. That's why dehumidification takes place. So, little bit of precipitation occurs. in every evaporator, little bit of precipitation occurs. Because the amount of moisture it was having in 30 degrees Celsius, it is not able to hold that in 20 degrees Celsius. It has to release that extra amount of moisture. That's why precipitation occurs. That's why you will find sometimes that from the air conditioner, water is dripping down. Water is dripping down. Okay. That's just because of dehumidification process that is taking place. Okay. You will find that from your air conditioner, whether it is split air conditioner, window air conditioner, water is dripping down because of this dehumidification process. Okay. Now everything about evaporator is clear to us. Now we will move to condenser. But before moving to condenser, one thing comes, that is compressor. We have to understand that. So we will start with compressor. See, we all know that compressor, pressure increases, temperature increases. This is the function that is occurring in compressor. But this is known by everyone. But the main question comes that whenever we want to send to condenser after from the evaporator, why we always require this compressor? Compressor is something that which we don't want, because for compressor you have to give power input. That is the main reason of your high electricity bill in That is the reason of your high electricity bill. But still, why we have to use compressor? That is the reason. Why we cannot directly send to condenser? See, I am explaining to you. Very simple. It is very simple. For that, we need to know that what happens in condenser. In condenser, heat rejection takes place. Heat is rejected by the refrigerant. I will tell you. Okay, don't worry. But what I am telling, just listen. Heat rejection takes place. The refrigerant loses heat to whom? To ambient. Okay. Now, my question is that what will happen if I don't use compressor? I am using evaporator. So, when the refrigerant is coming out from the evaporator, what is its temperature, approximate temperature, can you tell? Initial temperature in the evaporator, when the refrigerant was in liquid state, it was supposed 2 degrees Celsius. Okay, I told you. And after getting the heat from the warm room air, its temperature at the exit is supposed 10 to 12 degrees Celsius. Or you can say assume at 15 degrees Celsius. Okay. Now what is the temperature of the ambient? That means ambient outside in a summer time. Suppose 35 degrees Celsius. Now my objective is that I will not use compressor. I will directly send the refrigerant from evaporator to condenser for heat rejection. But my dear friend, so the refrigerant's final temperature is this much, I'm directly sending it to condenser. But my dear friend, is heat rejection from the refrigerant to the ambient will take place? Will the refrigerant be able to lose heat? No, because the temperature of the refrigerant is 15 degrees Celsius. But the temperature of the ambient is 35 degrees Celsius. So how heat can move from lower temperature to higher temperature? It is not possible. Instead, what will happen? Ambient will give heat to the refrigerant, which I don't want. Okay. That's why what is my objective? I have to take the temperature of the refrigerant somewhat more than 35 degrees Celsius. Suppose I want to make the temperature of my refrigerant to 50 degrees Celsius or 60 degrees Celsius so that it will be able to lose heat to the ambient. Okay? Now it will be able to lose heat to the ambient. That's why I require a compressor. Because in compressor what happens? The temperature and the pressure both increases. You understood why I require compressor? This is a very important and confusing question. Okay. But if you watch this video carefully, you will get the answer. I have explained to you. Okay. That is the main use of compressor. Okay. I have to raise the temperature of the refrigerant, that vapor refrigerant. When it is coming out from the evaporator, it is in vapor state. Okay, and its temperature is 15 degrees Celsius, but it is not able to lose heat to the ambient because it is much lesser than 35 degrees Celsius. So I have to send it into the compressor where the temperature will increase. Okay, the temperature will not only increase, but it will increase more than the ambient temperature. Then if I send it into the condenser, easily heat transfer will take place. Okay, so you understood why we require compressor. Now we will understand how this heat rejection process is happening in condenser in details. Okay, very important. So now we will understand about condenser. So the liquid, so the refrigerant from the compressor, it is coming in which form? Liquid or vapor? Vapor. Okay. It is entering into the condenser, and then after the heat rejection process, when the refrigerant will enter into the expansion valve, its state will be liquid. So it is entering and as gas or vapor, and it will leave from the condenser as liquid. Okay, now we will study about the heat rejection process that will occur here. It is beautiful. See, what is the temperature of this condenser coils? Can anybody tell me? The temperature of this condenser coils will be the temperature of the refrigerant that is coming from the compressor in the gaseous form. So what I assumed in my example previously, the temperature is suppose 50 to 60 degrees Celsius, suppose it is 55 degrees Celsius. Okay. Is it clear or not? Now, the ambient temperature. The ambient temperature is what? Ambient temperature. Ambient temperature is something 35 degrees Celsius. Is it clear or not? So, of course, heat rejection will take place. Heat rejection is possible. The refrigerant that is flowing through this condenser coils is at 55 degrees Celsius. And the ambient is at 35 degrees Celsius. But how this heat rejection will take place? I am saying that yes, heat rejection is possible in this case. Your refrigerant is at 55 degrees Celsius and your ambient is 35 degrees Celsius. Yes, heat rejection is possible. But how heat rejection will take place? That's why we require the movement of air. We require air flow through the condenser coils just as it has happened in evaporator coils. That's why we require a fan here. That's why we require an exhaust fan here. Okay. What this exhaust fan will do, suppose it rotates in clockwise direction. Then what will happen is that, now this image will be very helpful to you. Let me zoom it so that you can understand it better. See, Let me draw the fan which is here. You can see the fan, isn't it? There is a fan in front of the condenser coils. Now, what I told is that when it rotates in clockwise direction, when this fan starts rotating in clockwise direction, then what will happen is that the outdoor air will enter through the space here. The outdoor air will enter through the space provided here. Why? Because suction process will take place. Okay. Because suction process will take place. These types of fans are called propeller fans. Best thing is the best name which we can give it is propeller fans. In propeller fans, the air enters radially and leaves axially. Okay. Air enters radially and leaves axially. See what is happening when this fan starts to rotate in clockwise direction. The air will enter from the outdoor air will enter through this gap and it will move in this direction. When it will move in this direction, it will pass through these condenser coils. Okay. So when the air is passing out through this condenser coils to the ambient, it is leaving as extremely hot air because it is taking the heat of the refrigerant. Now I can show you here. See, when this propeller fan is starting to rotate in clockwise direction, this direction, a suction will take place. A suction, that means low pressure, will generate in this region. A suction will take place. That's why the outside air will move like this and it will pass through the condenser coils Is it clear or not? And heat rejection will take place. That means these condenser coils, the refrigerant that is passing through this condenser coil, it will lose heat. It will lose heat to the air. Okay. And when this air will leave like in this direction, it will leave as a warm air because its temperature is very high because it has taken the heat from the refrigerant that is flowing through this condenser coils. Is it clear or not? See, I can explain you this with the help of this diagram also. If you see the actual picture of a window air conditioner, when the condenser fans will start to rotate in clockwise direction, which is inside this, okay? You cannot see it. When the condenser fans will start to rotate, the air from the outside will enter through these passages. Okay, air from outside will enter through these passages. And it will leave in this direction and also in this direction. Okay. It will leave in these directions. Okay. As warm air. When it will leave, it will leave as warm air. Okay. You can understand this. When this condenser fan will start, the suction process will take place. The outside air will move through these gaps. Okay, and due to the action of this fan, the air will leave the condenser coils in this direction. And we know that warm air has a tendency to rise up. That's why here are also some gaps are provided so that the warm air can escape in this direction also. Okay, actually the air should have moved in this direction, and most maximum amount of air is moving in this direction only, but we know that warm air has a tendency to rise up because it is very lighter. That's why there are gaps provided here so that some amount of warm air can escape from here also. Is it clear or not? I hope that this is enough to make your concepts clear on the condenser coils. Now we have understood that what is happening to the air, how it is entering from this side and it is leaving in from that side. Okay, but what is happening to the refrigerant? The refrigerant, when it came from compressor, it came in the form of vapor. It came in gaseous state, okay, at high temperature and high pressure. But when it is passing through these condenser coils, what is happening is that it is rejecting heat to the ambient air. It is rejecting heat to the ambient air. And that's why its temperature is coming down. Okay. And what will happen is that phase transfer will take place. Because as its temperature comes down, it will reach to a temperature where it will suddenly change from gaseous to liquid. Okay. So in the condenser, phase transfer takes place. Okay, so in the condenser, phase transfer takes place. Is it clear to you or not? And during the time of phase transfer, the temperature of the refrigerant is constant. When it will completely change into liquid, then its temperature will suddenly decrease. And after that, now when it is leaving from the condenser, it is leaving in the form of liquid refrigerant, but its pressure is still high. Okay, its temperature is low, but its pressure is still high. So that's why somebody may get confused that when we draw the TS diagram, temperature remains constant in condenser. My dear friend, temperature is constant. I am agreeing to you, but this is not TS diagram, this is reality, what is happening in reality. Suppose you can assume that this from here to here it is condenser. So up to this portion you can assume the temperature is constant. But when it will enter into the expansion valve, what will happen? Its temperature and pressure both will suddenly decrease. Because we need to send it to the evaporator. Or you can say, indicate this evaporator coils. An evaporator is in low pressure. Okay. That's why this expansion valve is given, which suddenly decreases the pressure of the refrigerant. Okay. And again, this process continues. So we have understood the entire working principle of a air conditioner. Okay. Thank you very much. If you have any doubt, please ask in the comment box and please watch the full video. Okay, because if you don't watch full video, you won't be able to get the real meaning. Thank you very much.